I welcome you all. We will discuss research methodology today. Research is one subject which is very important today. The use of research in social sciences was started by sociologists to begin with. But later on, it was adopted by different scholars working in various academic disciplines. In order to brief you and focus your attention, I would like my discussion to narrow down to four questions. The first is, why research in social sciences? Why? What is the use of research in social sciences? Because the moment somebody speaks of research and research methodology in social sciences, there is a curiosity. Why? A subject matter or a theme which is done by established sciences or natural sciences like physics, chemistry, and others is being taught in the streams of social sciences. So this is the first basic questions. And the second is, what should be the subject matter of study in social sciences? When we are going to use the tools and technology of research in understanding social phenomena, what should be studied first? I mean, we should give our attention to which particular aspect of social phenomena? This is the second question. And the third important question is, and this is very vital, that you must understand, all of you should keep this mind, and this question has been debated time and again, that whether it is possible to get an objective view of social phenomena. Even if by employing technology and method of research in social sciences, in understanding social phenomena, in understanding human understanding interactions, is it possible to get an objective view? This is the third question. And the fourth one there is a debate regarding this that I'll discuss later on. But the fourth question that is very fundamental, is this long and still going on debate is futile or it has got certain relevant? So these are the questions we'll take up one by one. To begin with, the first question, why research in social sciences? As you know, research is kind of a quest of knowledge by deliberate attempt of human being. If somebody is doing some kind of research activities, he's trying to discover something or redefine something which is already existing, laws. For example, whenever I take a class of research methodology, I always cite this example that Newton was not the first man who discovered that the apple is coming down to earth. There must have been several people who must have watched this phenomena. But he kept on watching for several days and then came to conclusion that this is because of certain force, and that force is gravitational force of the earth. So what is being emphasized here is that Newton tried to establish a relationship between cause and effect. So whenever we are trying to do some kind of research activities, whether in laboratories or in social sciences, we try to establish the cause and effect relationship between two phenomena. You understand? So the question which is relevant, that why it was implied in social sciences. What happened that there was a phase in history, of the world history. I mean, it's a very long history. It started from 14th century onward, from 14th to 18th century, the world witnessed scientific revolution, and before that, commercial revolution. And these two things led for, later on to French Revolution and Industrial Revolution, and several other development, reformation, and then Renascença. So there was a kind of a reawakening. So people started thinking in terms of, scientifically. Earlier, in Middle Ages, everything was explained in terms of theology, metaphysics. And there was a phase when there was a shift in this whole perspective. And there is a oft-repeated dictum of Newton. Newton used to say, physics, beware of metaphysics. And this is, here is the breaking point. So what happened that now the people came to realize that it is not the sun that revolves around the earth, but the thing is just opposite. It is the earth that revolves around the sun. So this kind of thinking, when the leaders of the society, the intellectuals, the scholars, they realized that if we employ similar kind of method, similar kind of explanation, observation, comparison, experimentation, which are used by established sciences in physics, in astrology, in chemistry, if we use similar kind of method in understanding social phenomena, we can get better results. So that was the reason. That was the basic realization, that if we adopt similar kind of technique which are used by the natural scientists, physics, the people working in physics in the laboratories, we'll get better results. So that was the basic reason. Therefore, it was adopted by sociologists for the first time. And in this context, I would like to mention a couple of names. The founding father of sociology, called Auguste Comte, AUGUSTE COMTE. And you can check the spelling and the details about this man on that. Auguste Comte was a French scholar, and he was the first man who said the need of a science of society. If we want to understand the social phenomena, and we want to conclude, come to certain valid conclusion, we need to adopt those methods which are used by natural scientists. So this is one, Auguste Comte. Later on, persons like Herbert Spencer, and later on, Emile Durkheim was again a man from France. Spencer was a British. So these were the people. And perhaps the greatest contribution in this field was done by Emile Durkheim. He was the man who developed this perspective. And this perspective is called positivism. So now we are coming to the second question. The second question, if you remember, after all, what should be studied in social sciences? If we are going to use the method and technique of natural sciences in understanding social relations, in understanding values, in understanding culture, in understanding the tribal's behavior of the peasants, or the behavior of the industrial workers, what should be understood? What should be, where our focus should be concentrated on, which aspect of their behavior? So that was the basic question. Emile Durkheim said that as a social scientist, we should concentrate on the observable behaviors of the people. We want to understand why the people of one particular setting, one particular group, one particular society is behaving in one fashion. What are their behaviors? And Durkheim made it clear that let us concentrate on observable behaviors. Those behaviors of the people which are very obvious. And he not only emphasized on this aspect, he conducted a very landmark studies called suicide. And after a very detailed study of people, the people who committed suicide, he came to the conclusion that in all circumstances, whenever there is a case of suicide, whenever people commit suicide, there is a distance between the person who committed suicide and the group or the family or the society which he belongs. So there is a greater cases of suicides among the divorcees. There is a greater number of suicides among the Protestants. I hope you understand, you know what is this Protestant and what is this Catholic. There was a Reformation movement in Europe, and that was a protest movement against Christianity, the Catholic, those the established religious heads of those days. There was a movement first by Martin Luther King and later on by Calvinism. And that is called protest movement. So Durkheim found more cases of suicide among those who were the followers of the Protestants. More number of suicide among the divorcee, those who are not staying with their families. So he wanted to emphasize the fact that these behaviors are observable, and we should concentrate on this. And then he said that society or the social bond is the ultimate reason behind this. When there is a break, there is greater chances of committing suicide. And if you want to maintain this order, if you want to continue with this, we need to have a kind of a linkage between the social group and individual. There should be a close relation between the individual and society. So that was the basic theme. And later on, a large number of sociologists and anthropologists working in different fields, they have followed Durkheim, and they are still following this tradition. So that is the basic thing, is that you should know those who have some background of sociology or the commoners, they should keep in mind that this positivism emphasizes that let us concentrate only on observable behavior, those which are very obvious, which is objective, those which is apparent. So positivism is an emphasis on obvious, on apparent, on observable, and which is in front of you. You understand? You need not go behind. You look at on the face value. This is what he, though in a very occupied person, I can tell you. So this please keep in your mind. The other tradition, and equally important and equally vibrant, is called phenomenology. Phenomenologies, or sometimes it is also referred as interpretive sociology. And the greatest champion of this school of thought was a German philosopher who is very well known and very bright, a bright man of his days. His name is Max Weber, M-A-X space W-E-B-E-R. Max Weber is generally known in social sciences with his concept of bureaucracy. Max Weber is a very sophisticated scholar, and sometimes it's very difficult to understand Max Weber if you don't read Max Weber thoroughly. If you don't understand his methodology, it is very difficult to understand. You first understand his methodological outlook. What is methodology? Is nothing but the foundation of social sciences. It is the root, it is the clue, it is the logic behind everything. And everything is logical, everything is structured. So if Durkheim is saying that you need to understand the apparent behavior, those behavior which are observable, you will find this logic in his each and every work. His work on suicide, his work on division of labor, his work on rules of sociological method. These are the three important books written by Durkheim. Rules of sociological method, where he develops his this methodology, then second suicide, and third is elementary forms of religious life, where he talks of impact of religion on people, and the fourth, as I said, division of labor. Similarly, when you try to understand Weber, you should first of all try to understand his methodology. What is his methodology? And in a very simple term, I would say that Max Weber, he was a very sensitive man. He said, it's just not logical to look at what is observable and by looking at apparent, but by looking at the activities of the people, come to the conclusion is meaningless. It's futile. He said that social relations, the behavior of the people, the interactions of the people are subjective. He said that there is a fundamental difference between natural sciences, the established sciences, the laboratory sciences, and social sciences. Social sciences like sociology, anthropology, economics, history, political science, and media. Here, we are dealing with subjective aspect of people, not the objective one. We need to understand subjective thing, how people are behaving like this. Why? What is the reason behind it? So Weber gave much more importance to the question why. The subjective aspect of the behavior of the person. If somebody is behaving like one particular fashion, what is the reason behind this? If somebody is doing some act, what is the reason? What is motivating him to behave in that particular fashion? And this methodology he develops in his landmark study of Protestant ethics and the spirit of capitalism. So this one, first of all, you must keep in mind that he, instead of giving importance to observable behavior, Weber says that let us concentrate on subjective aspect of the phenomena. He says that there was rise of capitalism among Protestants because there was some idea behind this. There was some idea responsible for this development of capitalism. So mind it, my dear friend, he is at the same time, Weber, as I said, he was a very bright man. He was exposing both Durkheim and attacking Karl Marx. They have been contemporaries. They are the products of 19th century historical development. And their writings, 18th and 19th century, and the turn of the century, this is the period. All these three scholars are talking about and explaining. So Weber's first emphasis that let us concentrate on subjective, the meaning behind some action, not the action, the meaning behind the action. And I would like to make it more clear by giving the example of Protestant ethics and the spirit of capitalism. As I said, that Protestant was a movement against the established, the corrupt Christian order of those days in Europe. And there were two types of the Protestant movement in United States of America by Martin Luther King was a mild Protestant movement. But the movement called Calvinism, which was dominant in England, this was more radical. And unlike other Christian ethos, the Calvinists said that salvation is not possible outside the world. What is true is existing on the earth. So you need to work hard generate money, accumulate it, and this is law and this is profit. If you do hard work, save money, and accumulate wealth, this is the only way for salvation. God will be happy only when you earn money. You work hard, you don't spend your money on extravagant things, and you save money by carefully calculating. That is the only way out. So what Weber is trying to say, that this idea of Calvinist Protestant ethics promoted capitalism. And this is not simple explanation. He has compared every, he studies different religions. He studied Buddhism, he studied Christianity, he studied Hinduism, and he comes to the conclusion that in India and China, capitalism did not grow. It developed only among the Protestants. Why? Because there was a particular kind of religious ethos which promoted, which encouraged people to accumulate wealth. In case, in societies like India, where Hinduism was predominant or still dominating, the thinking is that the salvation, the moksha lies not in accumulating wealth, but doing good work. You see, if you do good work, let us not concentrate. Well, Gautam Buddha said everything is false. So this what Weber tries to say and emphasize, and very systematically he puts his point of view in his book. So the debate between positivism and phenomenology, the debate between one school developed by Auguste Comte, Spencer and Durkheim, and the other by Weber. This continues to debate, but the basic, the very, very fundamental question that we need to understand and ask, and that leads us to the third question. Is it possible to have an objective view of social phenomena? Is it possible to understand who are going to vote, which particular party? Can we say that one right now, are we in a position to predict that which particular party is going to win the election in Uttar Pradesh? This is the question. This is the question, and a large number of scholars have come to the conclusion that since social issues, social phenomena are fluid in nature, we are having a different kind of a view today. And maybe after a week, we think otherwise. Please remember, just I think 15 to 20 days before, there was a perception that Mayawati might win the election in Uttar Pradesh. It as well, there was a editorial just I think yesterday or day before yesterday in Times of India. And now, after this incident, when there was a quarrel in the dominant family of Uttar Pradesh, Samajwadi Party, and emergence of Akhilesh persona. This is what I'm quoting. What has been written in newspaper? I don't have any personal opinion regarding this, and I don't want to give my own assessment also. So what I am saying, that this has been written in an editorial of Times of India, and now there is a greater people are now saying that Akhilesh is emerging, fast emerging as a, he's leading the show. This is what, so what I am trying to say, that Just 15 days before, there was a different kind of opinion so far as Uttar Pradesh, development in Uttar Pradesh is concerned. And now the things have changed. What we say that in social science, it is very difficult to say this what is happening today will be the same after a couple of days or maybe next week. So this is the conclusion that the large number of scholars, whether it is Karl Mannheim or Evans Pritchard, they say that it is not possible to have complete objective reality of social phenomena because the nature is fluid. So the question remains that if it is not possible to have an objective reality in social sciences, so this whole exercise, the whole debate between the two contending schools are futile. Then there is no use of research in social sciences. No. This is what Weber points out. Weber was the man who said that it is still possible to have a better result. And this is the minute point we should understand. He said that we all know that human relations are abstract. It is not concrete. In order to come to certain relevant conclusion, we need to adopt two methods. Number one, we should try to understand some specific relationship. A specific relationship means we should not go for a grand theory. Let us concentrate on two units and try to understand. Let us concentrate on two phenomena and try to understand the relationship between one and the other. And number one, and second, it is futile to go for a grand general theory which is relevant for the world in every ages. So these two things, if we adopt, we can get better result, because there is a difference between natural sciences and social sciences. There is no doubt about it, but still natural sciences, or for example, social sciences deal with the same issues. What is that issue? That social sciences also, we try and all ages. So these two things, he said, let us narrow down to some particular things. So the last thing, the last point which we should discuss, and that is this debate futile? We'll be extend this discussion, because nowadays, if I say that this whole debate is futile, it is not genuine, because in different part of the world, scholars working in different disciplines, they have following the guidelines given by these two schools. Whether it is economics, it is history, field sociology, anthropology, there is a focus on observable behaviors of the people. People like Malinowski, people, a number of anthropologists, those who are working in tribal areas, they are watching this observable behavior. The ethnographers in Africa, in other countries where there are tribals, they that both these two schools of thought have been quite relevant, and this has encouraged the social scientists, those who are working in different streams of social sciences, they are adopting their methods and techniques. So if we come down to the techniques, approaches and methods of research method, we realize that the kind of research method we are adopting in understanding social phenomena. For example, when we are going for questionnaire or we are going for schedule, we are focusing on observable behaviors, concrete objective phenomena. We are just counting the numbers and counting the numbers. But when we are adopting case studies method, we are following the philosophy of Max Weber. Similarly, this comparative method of Durkheim and Weber is also adopted by cross-sectional studies, by longitudinal studies, by comparative studies of different people staying in different societies. So I think this is what research methodology deals with, and to conclude my discussion, I'd remind you again that as a persons of media, when you are going to explore, when you are going to work in the field, you should understand these guidelines, that you should not only talk to the people, you try to observe their behavior. If you are going to the field for reporting about their behavior, about their decision in the Uttar Pradesh Chunav or the election of Punjab, you should look at different dimensions, their behavior in details. Let us don't rely on whatever they are saying. Thank you much. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, all right.